Companies Act 2013 is a landmark legislation giving legal recognition to corporate social responsibility, CSR. It has created the grounds for CSR to grow from an act of philanthropy to a strategic intervention to usher in tangible socio-economic changes at the grassroots level.
We need to craft a legislation for India, by India, in India. This is a unique Indian concept of CSR. And it is Indian because the idea here was to ensure that CSR initiatives linked to our development goals. How do we use corporate money to enhance the efforts of government to ensure that people at the grassroots level actually benefit?
Such a partnership is especially critical in a state like Odisha, with its myriad developmental challenges. To explore the scope and extent of such collaboration, CYSD, in association with IIPCA, NFI and UNICEF, organized a day-long brainstorming in Bhubaneswar on January 2015.
Now the best part of this conference is trying to, you know, analyze the gap between the need and what is available, and trying to find out who are the major stakeholders who can look into this lead, identify the need properly, and then find out how to do it actually.
It's an agenda setting event. And the three clear objectives which we have set, clear concrete agenda for CSR in Odisha, from a tokenism activities to a substantive engagement. How do we build alliance and coalition between all the major players actually in development? The corporate sector, the civil society organizations, you know, sometimes we don't talk to each other, we don't look at each other, we suspect each other, and there is a veil of mistrust also between us. So how do we really bridge that mistrust? How do we talk openly? How do we confront each other in a very constructive way so that the agenda of development can be pursued?
Odisha is a land of ironies. Under the ground, it is among the richest states in India with its vast mineral resources. But over the ground, there is abject poverty, malnutrition and hunger. The state that is among the top three investment destinations in the country is also the state which is at the rock bottom when it comes to human development indicators. Given its enviable mineral wealth beneath the ground, viewing all corporates with suspicion and staying away from industrialization is not an option. And given the grinding poverty above, not doing anything about it is not an option either. So how does one deal with this dichotomy? How does one get the best of both the worlds? It is here that CSR comes in and provides new vistas of cooperation and collaboration for all stakeholders to the collective benefit of the people.
How do we recognize certain elements in making a sustainable impact, and how do we bring relative core competence, the USP of different partners around the table? If awareness generation and social mobilization is critical, that's where a lot of grassroots level civil society organizations have core competence. If policy making, legal frameworks, public resource mobilization is the core competence of the government, that's where they have to bring their USP. The core competence of the private sector is not money. Some people have commented on it. It's also much more important, a capacity to implement at a scale.
It is not difficult to see what each of the three partners, the government, the corporate sector and the civil society, can bring to the table. The government has the resources, both financial and human, while the corporates have the technical skills to run scalable pilot projects and civil society to reach and connect with the grassroots. It is obvious that corporates occupy the middle space in the three-way partnership. They have to work with the government on one side and the civil society on the other.
The money that the corporates can put in is only going to be a fraction of what the government has with it. The infrastructure that the government has, or the effectiveness that the government can bring to the table, is much more than what a single corporate can do. We can't boil the ocean, but we can work with the government to try and do something more effective than what we can do ourselves. So there is a need for us to engage more closely with the government, understand what the priorities of the governments are, and learn to work with that.
Here you see there is a dark background. Dark background is nothing but violence, all the evils that is there in the society. So you see again three ladies, they are putting small lamps together and trying to light and the darkness to go away. I feel these three ladies are nobody other than the government, the corporate and the civil society.
With their reach, connect and relationship of trust with the people at the grassroots level, civil society organizations are uniquely positioned to put the resources to the most effective use. They can dovetail such initiatives to existing government programs to usher in real change on the ground.
We did not expect corporates to create an army of people who would carry out CSR. The idea here is companies should outsource their CSR activities to the civil society sector and allow NGOs, trusts, Section 8 companies, not-for-profit companies, to actually execute programs on the ground.
There are dozens of issues that need attention in Odisha. But the three most important ones among them are poverty, disaster preparedness, sanitation and hygiene. Even as the economy of the state grew at a rate higher than the national average over the last decade, poverty manifest in hunger, malnutrition and high infant and maternal mortality has refused to come down to acceptable levels. More than 30% of people in the state still remain below poverty line, while there are pockets of extreme deprivation, particularly in the tribal belt, where hunger and malnutrition is endemic.
The corporate sector has a very important concern and interest in overall economic growth of a country or economy where they function, or from where they get their customers. And CSR is nothing but a mechanism, statutory mechanism, which can valuably contribute to the overall economic growth of the society.
Maternal and infant mortality rates are the manifestations of chronic poverty and malnutrition. Unfortunately, both maternal mortality rate MMR and infant mortality rate IMR remain unacceptably high in Odisha despite considerable effort to arrest them.
We have a project which is a multi-collaborative project running for the last 4 years in a tribal-dominated pocket of Saraikela. It is in partnership with the American India Foundation, Dr. Abhay Bang of Search in Garchiroli in Maharashtra, and of course with the National Rural Health Mission. And in the last 4 years, I'm happy to report that we have reduced neonatal mortality by 26% in one entire block of Saraikela.
Another area where the corporate can contribute significantly is the use of cutting-edge technology in poverty eradication. The corporate sector can make available such technology and even develop a new technology to supplement efforts of the government and the civil society in amelioration of poverty.
The NGO sector can certainly benefit with from some of the tools, some of the some of the systems which we can probably put in place. It might not be direct CSR implementation, but it'll help in the final outcome, certainly, and in assessing impact, which is what, you know, corporates use TCS software to do.
Sure.
So we are very keen that the sector more and more appreciates that this is available to them. In a small way, we are doing this in Orissa. We are supporting the Orissa Tribal Empowerment and Livelihood Mission, the OTEL project of Orissa, in streamlining their software as part of our CSR, and we're doing it completely free of cost, because we believe that, you know, if that is effective, the end result is that the tribals benefit.
One of the major reasons for the high levels of poverty in the state is the sorry state of its agriculture. In the absence of irrigation facilities, a majority of farmers are dependent on and indeed at the mercy of the rain gods. If the rain fails, as they often do, the crops fail as well.
Today, our GDP from agriculture is just about 16.5%, whereas more than 60% of our people depend on agriculure. So the per capita income of the people depending on agriculture is low. So what we need to do is focus more on agriculture and livelihood areas.
Displacement is another reason for the rapid decline of agriculture and rise in poverty. Vast tracts of erstwhile agriculture land are gobbled up by development projects, including industry, leaving no option for their erstwhile owners to look for other avenues to earn a livelihood.
My father, 13 acre, 18 decimal, jai jai gya. Ebe bi ame kichhi painu, nirupayo, agya mo paribar ro, mo chuto chuto pila mane.
The impact of poverty is compounded manifold by the fact that Odisha is a land of diverse and extreme climatic conditions. If the coastal plains bear the brunt of frequent floods, cyclones, tsunami, the drier western and southern regions are highly vulnerable to drought. Natural disasters not only take a heavy toll of human and animal life, but also do lasting damage to social and physical infrastructure, pegging back development in the process. More often than not, a new disaster strikes even before the damage caused by the last one is fully repaired.
It's a land of agrarian community. Those community is getting seriously affected by these climatic variations. And the rain-fed agrarian economy that we have, because of lack of irrigation facilities which we have not been able to provide to every inch of land, the return of our investment is decreasing. So the farmer, the majority of our community is becoming poor day by day. They are into a business where they are investing more, whereas they are getting less. So most of the cases when we walk into the villages and we talk about a long-term future, about 5 years or 10 years, our communities doesn't even really are capable to look at a 5-10 years ahead of them, because for them survival for the today is an important question. So there is no question of tomorrow and then looking at 5 years down the lane.
The constant tryst with disasters, however, has had at least one major benefit: resilience. The 1999 super cyclone was the watershed event in this context. It triggered off a long process of building capacities to face disasters and minimize casualties.
Control calling India 3, India 6.
The investment made in terms of these preparatory measures paid rich dividends at the time of cyclone filing in October 2012, when human casualties were kept at the minimum.
All of us had took a place post 99, come what may, we would learn how to live with disasters, but would not allow loss of lives again. And that we have been able to do it.
While corporates have done their bit in relief and rehabilitation measures, after every natural disaster, there is still a certain reluctance to rope them into the preparedness exercise.
Generally, if you see, the best of the socially responsible corporates in India are really responding for response. They are responding to disasters and they are in mitigation. But the answer is the other two: the preparedness, the preventive measure. Whether corporates are treated so far as effective partners, partnering with the people, partnering with the government, for both, for preparedness, for preventive measures, and for the rehabilitation and the cares.
The relationship between poverty, health, and sanitation and hygiene is generally not understood in India. That is why sanitation has not received the kind of attention and priority it deserves. Sanitation and development are interwoven. Think, 88% of under 5 deaths are associated with the factor lack of access to water sanitation and hygiene all over the world. Open defecation contributes to stunting. Adolescent girls often drop out from schools due to lack of toilets. 6.4% of India's GDP is lost due to inadequate sanitation facilities. Safety of women is a threat due to open defecation. 600 million people in India go for open defecation. In Odisha, 75% people do not have access to toilets. There is effort from all sector. Government has tried many ways to address this critical concern. But alas, all in vain. It is possible that sanitation has not received its due priority because it has not been sold properly.
And from our experience, we know that an inferior commodity, better packaged, more intensively, aggressively advertised, sells more than a superior commodity. And private sector knows this art much better than any of us sitting here, from a civil society. So sanitation has to be sold in a very psychologically tricky and appealing manner. And this part can be taken up by industry and in a much better manner.
Individual household toilet construction is not enough. What is imperative that we ensure that communities as a whole adopt open defecation-free practices. We're taking a look at functionality of girls' toilets in schools. Now, we're all aware that, you know, that one is the problem of not having toilets and the other is that of having toilets, but toilets that are completely unusable.
One of the major reasons for toilets becoming unusable is the unavailability of water.
পরিষ্কার হওয়ার মূল কারণ হচ্ছে যে পানির অভাবে তেমন আমি টিউবওয়েলু পানি নেই হ্যান্ডপম্পর পানি নেই সেটি বালতিতে রাখুছু এবং পিলামানে ইউরিনাল করে সেলা পরে সেটিকে ঢালুচন্তি কিন্তু স্পেশাল গোটে বোরিং পয়েন্ট হয় কিছু পানি যদি সেই সাপ্লাই করি হওয়া ট্যাপ সিস্টেম হইতা তাহলে সেটা টিকে ভালো পরিষ্কার হতা
ইন্ডাস্ট্রিয়ালাইজেশন ইনএভিটেবলি ব্রিংস ইন দ্য প্রবলেম অফ পলিউশন দ্য এয়ার ওয়াটার এন্ড সয়েল অফ দ্য এরিয়া ওয়্যার দ্য ইন্ডাস্ট্রি ইজ লোকেটেড becomes polluted, posing a threat to the health of both humans and animals.
Dust, sir, it is very problem. Matter dust, or which as jaha ki plant, sir, challe affected, or which I am first, sir, 80 meter distance, sir, 80 meter, kindo amar rosse ghara bitter agar dust padi jao chhi. Jaha ki ame paniya jalo bhi bhala apne nahi paronu. Jaha ki amar kidney swasthya amo ghare bhi madhya do tin jano kidney re akranta hi chalani. Jaha ki affected ho chhi, sir, dust hi dust plant or dust hi asigi. Ame sir, kono si mane loga kapda khande bhi bahar madhya sukhai paronu.
The day-long deliberations helped chart out a roadmap for the future where each of the three stakeholders, the government, the corporate sector and the civil society, collaborate and cooperate with each other to usher in real, qualitative and sustainable change in the lives of people. But this obviously can come about only when CSR is mainstreamed into the corporate philosophy.
CSR cannot be a corner office. It needs to be integrated into day-to-day business, and then we have to align ourselves towards the national goals and the MDGs.
That we are clearly looking at several verticals, 5-6 different verticals, around which different corporates, different NGOs could start coming together. But the idea of a comprehensive, say, Odisha development initiative is something that we need to work on.
The focus will be on these two aspects, the strategic aspect and the partnership, how to achieve the strategic goal of CSR. Strategic goal not from the state's point of view, but also corporate
company's point of view, how this can be achieved and have a multiplier effect through a dynamic partnership.
This workshop can be a platform, can be a base for synthesizing all these activities of different companies, so that we have a kind of, if we can have a roadmap and a comprehensive plan for CSR activities for all the companies.
If there was one message that came out loud and clear from the workshop, it was that shedding mutual suspicion and coming together have to be the cornerstone, the new mantra, if you please, of the new paradigm of development.
When we all come together, I'm sure 1 plus 1 is 11, but 1 plus 1 plus 1 is 111.